We thank you for the breath of life, your first gift to us. We have come to this holy and sacred place to give thanks, to offer up gratitude, and to love and be loved by one another. Nancy, will you now usher us into a time of worship? Thank you, my dear Nancy, for that wonderful prelude, beautiful music. We now come to the call to worship in our service this morning that is printed in your bulletin, and we're being led by our beloved deacon, Miss Anne Pollander, this morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship that's in your bulletin. We come as seekers. We come as followers.
You tell us, come to me, all of you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest.
We come to worship.
You tell us, where two or three are gathered together in your name, you will be in our midst.
Holy One, by your grace, meet us here, we are. Meet us here, meet us now. Amen.
Amen, church. Oh, and the quote this morning by a beloved mystic theologian who I hold dear, Howard Thurman, advises us to don't ask what the world needs, ask what makes you come alive, and go do it. Because what the world needs is people who have come alive. Amen. This brings us to our first hymn of the morning, friends. Holy, 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 hymn 323. Holy, 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 I invite you to stand if you are able and if you would like to sing praises to our God. Hymn 323, holy, holy, holy. Let's sing praises together.
Holy, holy,
Oh, please remain standing for word of prayer. You all sound so good this morning. Let us pray, church. Loving God, we have come into this sacred place to lift up gratitude to you. Through the week, Lord, there may have been moments where the sunshine broke through, a smile was brought to our lips, a twinkle in our eye, our hearts were touched as we were loved by friends and family. Maybe we sat down to a warm meal in a warm house, got a call from a friend or a loved one, but something this week affirmed for us that we are loved. And we've come here today to say thank you. To say thank you for all the good and perfect gifts we have received this past week and all the time before. Lord, we invite your spirit into this place this morning. Let us not leave here without having felt a touch from you. We beg of you to commune with us in this place, to dine with us in this place, to abide with us in this place. Let us feel you close, God. Let us feel the divine spirit intimately, as if the very breath of God were blowing at the nape of our neck. We want to feel you close. Honor our service here this morning. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. All right, friends, we have a really exciting portion of today's service. We have incredible opportunity to officially welcome some new members into the fold, members who've been with us for some time, but have had it in their heart to join us officially to say to this community, to this town, that we are members of the United Church of Lincoln. And I am delighted for this opportunity. And so I will call forth now Tim and Carol Bradford, if you'll come forward and stand in front, and also Grace Freeman, if you'll come down and stand in front, and Ian as well. Wonderful. Grace and Ian, come down and stand here. So first, just a brief introduction. You know these wonderful people so well, but here we have Tim and Carol Bradford. Tim is originally from Ohio, and Carol is originally from California. And in 2019, they came here to Lincoln. They were pen pals before they fell in love and decided to marry. I'm understanding that your first kind of date or meetup was at the Lincoln General Store. Now, that's not authentically Lincoln, I don't know what it is. Next we have Grace and Ian Freeman. Grace and her family came to
to Burlington in 1991. Ian was 3 years old at the time. And Grace's family used to own, or still owns maybe, the old schoolhouse.
It's in the family still.
It's in the family still, the old schoolhouse of deep, deep Lincoln ties. Ian was born in Middlebury, is that right? Vermont, just up the way. And Grace has been, and Ian have been blessing us with their beautiful voice in the choir for quite some time. So we are thrilled to have you, Ian, and you, Grace, to be presented for membership. Grace comes by a letter of a transfer, meaning her membership was held in a previous church, and now we are transferring that letter to the United Church of Lincoln. It's sort of the Baptist way of doing things. And Tim and Carol are coming by a profession of faith. And so, given that, I just have a couple questions for you. Is it in your heart to follow the example of Jesus as it leads to love and mercy and justice in the world today? You do. And do you pledge to do that in community with your fellow brothers and sisters at the United Church of Lincoln?
Yes.
And lastly, to now Grace and Ian and Tim and Carol, do you vow to offer your gifts and your talents to the beautiful tapestry of this church and also allow us to love you, serve you, and walk alongside you as your official church family? If you agree with that, please respond by saying, I do. And church, if you accept Grace and Ian and Carol and Tim as bona fide, full-fledged, card-carrying members of the United Church of Lincoln, please signify that by standing to your feet.
Thank you.
Oh, come on, choir. What can't you do?
Dishes.
Dishes. Lord of the dance. My. Thank you for that rousing selection. We've now come to a super special time in our worship where we get to have a conversation with our little friends. Are there any little friends in the building? If you can make your way down. I see some little friends out there. Come on down. Let's give them a hand clap as they come on down. Welcome. Oh, yes. Oh, it's so good to see you all. So good to see you all. Just going to do a quick check-in. How are we doing, little friends? Good morning, Madison. Good to see you, Maya. All right. I promised them yesterday I would be with them. It's good to see all of you.
Excited to be here?
Yeah.
We're thrilled to have you.
And today, we have a very special message prepared just for you, and that's coming from our very own Glenn Semple. So, get excited, get comfortable. Glenn, take it away.
Good morning. Got a question for you. How many of you have ever been to the lake and got to play in the water? Oh, so you've been on the beach and you were able to look out across the water? Well, today I want to share a Thanksgiving story with you. May I do that? There was a time when James, Peter, and John, y'all recognize those names? Those guys in the Bible? Well, they went fishing. And they fished all night long. Now, these guys were professional fishermen. They didn't catch nothing. And so early in the morning, there was a man that was standing on the shore. And he hollered out to them, "Hey, children, you got any fish?" And John said, "No, we ain't got none. We've been fishing all night and ain't caught a one." And this man said, "Well, why don't you try the other side of the boat? Throw your nets on the other side of the boat." And John looked at Peter like, "Who does he think he is? He probably don't know nothing." "Well, let's do it anyway," Peter said, because Peter was done agitated. So they threw their nets on the other side of the boat. And my goodness, the nets filled up so much, it was almost turned the boat over. And James looked at Peter and said, "That's the Lord." And Peter jumped off and left them in the boat with the turning over and the fish pulling in. And he swam in to see the Lord because he hadn't seen him in a while. And so they pulled the nets up, you know, and they get up to the shore. And the Lord already had a fire and fish and bread on the fire. And my goodness, how did he do that? But that's not the biggest portion of the story. So as they were sitting around, they were so thankful. They'd been working all night and they were hungry. I don't know if you've ever seen your dad hungry before, but man, men get hungry when they work. And they were eating fish and eating bread. And Jesus looked at Peter and said, "Peter, do you love me more than these?" Peter said, "Yeah, Lord, I love you." He said, "Okay." So he went back, talked to James and John. Then he turned to Peter again and said, "Feed my sheep." Peter looked at him, "Uh-oh, okay." And then he asked him again. He said, "Peter, do you love me more than these?" Peter put the fish down for a minute and said, "What's he trying to ask me?" He said, "Well, Lord, you know I love you." He said, "Well, feed my lambs." Okay, what's that mean? John, what's that mean? And he went back to talking to James and John. And then he finally looked at Peter one more time. Have you ever had your parents ask you three times in a row, "Did you do that? Did you, will you do that?" Have you ever had that happen? Well, this is what happened to Peter. He said, "Peter, do you really love me more than these?" And Peter's heart got sad and he turned his lip up. Y'all ever done that? You ever did that? Yeah, I bet you did. I tell Maya I did it before. And he said, "Well, Lord, you know I love you. You know everything." He said, "Feed my sheep." And so today we have an opportunity to bring some food to the food bank. Because there are folks out there that don't have enough food every day to eat. And we're going to have opportunity to share food with them so they might have more to eat the coming weeks. So would you do me a favor? Would you all get up and go back in and bring all those bags up here and put them right in front of the altar? Some of you older folks may need to help them because there's some big, heavy bags. Just put them right there. There you go. Woo, Lena, look at you go. Maya, yes. All right. Thank you. So what do I do with that? Good job. Oh my goodness, there's more coming. Wow, look at this. Isn't this a great blessing? Aren't we thankful for everyone who donated? Thank you, children, for doing this. We appreciate you. And now before we pray, I was just told a very special person has a birthday on Tuesday. Guess who? Haley. Can we sing it? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Haley. Happy birthday to you. Pastor.
Happy birthday, Haley. Happy birthday. We love you. The last time you're in church, you know that, right?
Yeah. Friends, let's have a quick word of prayer before you guys are off. But before that, this is amazing. I am moved deeply. They shall know we are Christians by our love. And look what the church can do. You guys are wonderful. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for the gift of generosity, that when the community puts a need out there, there are people who will stand up to be counted, to come forward in the name of love to do something about it. I'm grateful for the generosity of this church and this town. Bless this food. Let it nourish the families who are in desperate need right here in this community. We thank you for the children participating so that they may get it in their blood what it is to be generous, that they may see from us what it means to love thy neighbor, to be thy brother and thy sister's keeper. We pray this in your name. Amen. All right, friends, off to Sunday school you go. We'll wave to our young friends as they're off and celebrate them for their contribution as they're off to Sunday school with Christ. Amen. Friends, that brings us to our next hymn of the morning, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. It's a favorite of many, I know. Come Thou Fount. I invite you to stand. Hymn number 318. 318, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Please stand if you are able and would like to. Hymn 318, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. Let's sing praises together to our God.
thank you. You may be seated. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Next, we'll have our scripture reading for this morning. It comes from the Gospel of John, and it will be led this morning by our deacon, Linda Half.
Good morning. So you'll find it in your Bibles on page 874, John 11. We'll start on 32. I'll read the first, and you can follow on the odd verses. And this is a verse where Jesus, in his caring for humanity, actually weeps at the loss of his friend. It's very moving. I missed the large print, so I'll be reading slowly. Okay. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died."
When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved.
He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see."
Jesus began to weep.
So the Jews said, "See how he loved him."
But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?"
Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it.
Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days."
And Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?"
So they took away the stone. Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for having heard me.
I knew that you would always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me."
When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out."
The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." This is the word of God.
Thank you, Linda. Friends, that was the gospel of the Lord, and we say, thanks be to God. We've now come to the preaching moment. That sacred Kairos moment where we knock on the pearly gates of heaven and beckon our God to come down. Won't you pray with me? In the words of Barbara Brown Taylor, "Come, Holy Ghost, our souls inspire, enlighten us with your celestial fire. For if you are not with us, divine love, then nothing else matters. And if you are with us, then nothing else matters. Be with my beloved church this morning, Lord, we plead and we pray. Amen." I get what it means when it says Jesus wept. As a young Baptist, Southern Baptist, Glenn, growing up with scripture memorization contests, I could confidently say that John 11:35, "Jesus wept," was the shortest verse in the Bible. An easy one to get points for. But then I went to seminary, and things got, well, complicated. Shortest verse in English or in the original Greek, the professor would ask. And which English translation? Oh boy. So while Jesus wept may be the shortest verse in the Bible or not, that's robustly debatable, but I at least know what it means. He cried. Whether because his dear friend was dead or because his close friends thought it was too late for him to do anything about it, or both, but he cried. However, before Jesus cried, he experienced another strong emotion. And you read that in verse 33. But what does verse 33 mean? What does it mean that Jesus was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved? Many believe that this is just John, the writer of this gospel, elaborating on the weeping, on the intense emotion Jesus might be feeling about the death of his friend Lazarus. But this morning, church, I'm here to tell you that it's more complicated than that. The English translation, greatly disturbed in spirit, comes from a complex Greek phrase. And because this phrase has haunted me for several weeks, I will now graciously share it with you. The phrase is embrimaomai. Embrimaomai. And there is a cluster of meanings. But most scholars agree that it is a deep guttural groan inspired by anger. It is to sternly charge. It is often associated with horses to mean an angry or emotional grunt or snort. In essence, it's an anguished groan. So where does that leave us? Well, let's look at the context. In the 11th chapter of the Gospel of John, we find the seventh and final sign of Jesus, as recorded by John. And in the course of Jesus' life, he has become very close friends with this little family from Bethany. Two sisters, Mary and Martha, and their brother Lazarus. And Jesus loves Lazarus. Lazarus has fallen ill, and so the sisters send a message to Jesus to come quickly, lest he die. Jesus declines and stays where he is. And by the time Jesus finally makes it back to Bethany, Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. A crowd has formed. And the sisters, not surprisingly, are experiencing very strong emotions. And they're not just experiencing very strong emotions, they are expressing very strong emotions. They are angry and grief-stricken. And the crowd is seeing all of this. They don't understand why Jesus waited. They both say, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. And the rest of the story is quite simple. Jesus tells them not to worry. He asks to be taken to the tomb of Lazarus. He commands someone to remove the stone in front of the grave. He calls for Lazarus to come forth. And Lazarus does. Amidst the four-day stench of death, a man appears bound in strips of cloth, and Jesus commands, unbind him and let him go. Unbind him and let him go. And that's the story, folks. But before Jesus calls Lazarus forth, he also experiences very strong emotions, and he also expresses those very strong emotions. Jesus weeps,
But before he sheds a single tear, he experiences this other strong emotion, this embry ma'omai, this anguished groan. Before Jesus reacts to the death of his beloved friend with tears, he reacts to something else with an anguished groan. What was happening with Jesus? As with many biblical insights, the clues for this come before and after the text. Before and after the raising of Lazarus, right before Jesus receives the message of the death of Lazarus, he is on the opposite side of the Jordan River, having escaped an execution. That's right, friends. Good Friday is not the only time an arrest and execution was attempted on Jesus. Right before this Lazarus story, Jesus was in Jerusalem, in the temple, and the religious leaders who were stalking Jesus, they were concerned with one thing and one thing only. Was Jesus claiming to be God? You see, the tradition allowed for great prophets, for great men and women of God, Elijah and Elisha, Deborah and Esther, Gideon and Rahab, they all, through God, did some miraculous and heroic things, but none of them, not a single one, claimed to be God. So as the religious leaders are following Jesus around, even seeing him perform miracles and signs, their ears are burning to hear just one thing: blasphemy. And just a few days before Lazarus dies, Jesus is in Solomon's temple chatting with some religious leaders, and it happens. He gives the strongest statement about his divinity yet recorded. In John chapter 10 and verse 30, Jesus says, "The Father and I are one." And there it was. That's what they needed. And immediately, they took up stones to stone him. Then they put hands on him to arrest him. And the Bible says Jesus escaped from their hands. And where did this heart-pounding scene take place? Just 2 miles from the house of Lazarus. When Jesus escaped death, he crossed the Jordan River to get away from the place right near the house of Lazarus. So when Jesus receives the message to come back to the neighborhood where the house of Lazarus is, he knew he would be returning to a place that had a bounty on his head. And the disciples also knew. They begged him not to go. They said, "Rabbi, that the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" So he went there again, knowing they were looking to kill him, knowing that if he did anything that further pointed to his divinity, to his being God, he would likely not escape death a second time. So here he is. Can you see him, church? Here he is being begged by people he loves so dearly to be God, to perform a miracle. And not just any miracle, but up to this point in the Gospel of John, there are 6 recorded signs. He turns water into wine. He heals an official son. He heals a lame man. He feeds the multitudes. He walks on water, and he heals a man born blind. Wine, food, disease, that's one thing. But resurrection? That's another. The religious leaders of the time firmly believed in resurrection, but only on the judgment day. only at the end of the age. So to do it now would not just be saying that you are God. For Jesus, it would be some kind of proof. If Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead right now, he would be sealing his fate. It would set into motion that dark day on Calvary's Hill. It would be the point of no return. Now, is that worthy of an anguished groan? And sure enough, some in the crowd, after witnessing the raising of Lazarus, they run to the Pharisees and the high priest. They call a meeting of the council. And friends, we have a transcript of that meeting. We have the meeting minutes, Pat Valancourt. What are we to do, they say. What are we to do, they say. This man is performing many signs, and if we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and destroy both our holy place and our nation. So from that day on, they plan to put him to death. What are we to do? They say. It was the point of no return. In these divided times, church, are we prepared for our points of no return? As we attempt to follow the path of Jesus, knowing full well where it leads, are we prepared for our points of no return? Being together in this gorgeous sanctuary on a Sunday morning is wonderful, life-giving, nourishing, but I doubt it will confound the powers that be. I doubt it will shake the system outside unless what we do in here affects what we do out there. The way we love in here, the way we show grace in here, the way we exhibit kindness in here has to spill over from the four walls of this building and flood this community. As Dr. King said, let it flow down like waters and righteousness as a mighty stream. What if we decided to recommit ourselves to speaking truth to power? What if we said to systemic racism, to unbind marginalized people of color and let them go? What if we said to the purveyors of misogyny and sexism, to unbind her and let her go? What if we said to the leaders in power who are preying on our trans kids and kids with different gender identities and expressions, to unbind them and let them go? What if we said to the prison industrial complex who makes big money on incarcerating our disproportionately black and brown and poor siblings, to unbind them and let them go? What if we said to polluting industrial corporations with a death grip on our environment, to unbind the planet and let it go? What if we said to our evangelical Christian nationalist siblings who are perverting the image of Jesus, to unbind the gospel and let it go? What if we said to the sharpest edge of our capitalistic system, who makes the most profit in human history and yet is content with homeless neighbors, chronic poverty, and hungry children, to unbind our safety nets and let them go? Does our current faith commitment have anything to say about chronic poverty? Jesus did. Does your faith have anything to say about our siblings on the street?
Because Jesus did. Does your faith have anything to say about how we treat the refugee and the immigrant and the stranger? Because Jesus did. Does the way we practice our faith leave the self-centric world around us asking, what are we to do? If someone out there is planning to prop up hate, when we show up, it should leave them asking, what are we to do? If someone out there is planning to prop up racism, white supremacy, when we show up, it should leave them asking, what are we to do? If someone out there is planning to treat others like anything other than a child of God, when we show up, it should leave them asking, what are we to do? Jesus knew that this seventh sign, this raising of a dead man in public view, would be the point of no return. But with you in mind, beloved, and with me in mind, he did it anyway. He did it anyway. With him in mind, what might you be willing to do anyway? Amen. At this moment, friends, we will observe the tradition of our Quaker friends and have a moment of holy silence. We will honor the discipline of silence as we transition out of the sermon. All right, friends, that brings us to our last hymn of the morning, hymn number 580. There shall be showers of blessings. Hymn number 580. I invite you to stand if you are able and if you would like to. Hymn number 580. There shall be showers of blessing. Let's stand and sing praises to our God.
Showers of blessing, please. blessing we need.
Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the shutters we plead.
Friends, let's do that fourth verse and chorus a cappella. Nancy, give us the notes. Let's sing together, church.
There shall be showers of blessing. Oh, that today they might fall. Now as to God we're confessing, now as on Jesus we call. Showers of blessing, showers of blessing we need. Mercy drops round us are falling, but for the showers we plead.
Thank you, friends. Please remain standing for these words of benediction. Friends, let us love so radically. Let us show kindness so radically. Let us show grace so radically. Let us stand for justice so radically that we leave the world wondering, what are we to do? Friends, may the road rise to meet you. May the wind blow at your back. May the sun shine warmly on your face. May the rain fall softly on your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the very palm of her hand. Go in peace, my friends, to love and serve the Lord. Amen.